So I have great pleasure in introducing Rajeshwari Sengupta, who is currently a visiting fellow at Indira Gandhi Institute of Development Research. Her research focuses on international finance and open economy, macroeconomics, and specifically on policy relevant macrofinancial issues of emerging markets. In the past, she has held research position at IFMR Chennai, RBI, and World Bank in Washington. Over to you, Rajeshwari Sengupta, for making the presentation. Ladies and gentlemen, Rajeshwari.
Economy, which kind of catapulted the US dollar to an international reserve currency status. While the US economy overtaken UK in terms of size in the late 1870s, the two main factors missing in terms of its essential attributes were stability and liquidity, because there was a series of financial crashes in early 1900s and liquidity wasn't sufficient in the US financial markets. What changed, and one single most important factor that changed, was in 1913, the Federal Reserve Act was established the independent central bank in the US. And that came about as the central bank becoming the lender of last resort and providing liquidity support to the financial markets. So the posters, I put them up because back then when the internet was not around, the Federal Reserve would actually put out posters saying that it stands for liquidity and it stands for stability. And that message was very important for the financial investors to start having confidence and faith in US dollar. And along with that, of course, several other measures were taken to establish a credible monetary regime, to have enough checks and balances in place, to have a deep financial market. So as a result of all of these, by 1924, the striking development was that the dollar had emerged as an international reserve currency alongside the pound. And this happened in a span of 10 to 15 years, that short a period of time. Which the US lesson actually goes to tell us that concerted policy reform and institutional innovation can help develop a liquid market to support the international status of a currency. Because that was a very important lesson to learn. Of course, during the 30s and 40s, there were a lot of turbulence. The dollar credibility took a significant amount of hit. But by 1994, dollar was a force to reckon with in terms of FX reserves and bonds denomination. And by late 1930s, this was post-Great Depression, the dollar had actually overtaken the pound sterling as a currency of denomination for international bonds. So this graph shows you the currency share of global denomination of bonds. And the red line is the dollar, the black is the pound sterling. And you can see that around late 1930s, the dollar had overtaken, what comes as green is black here, so the green line is the British pound. The dollar had taken over the pound as the currency of choice for denomination of foreign bonds. And that was a striking phenomenon that had happened. And since then, it has been the main currency of choice for bonds denomination. And of course, post the Second World War, the international economy organized itself around the dollar, and the US was the predominant economy for all practical purposes. And this was also the time of the dollar standards, where countries were pegging their currencies to the dollar. What happened since then, from the 1940s to about late 1960s and 70s, the US economy consistently provided political stability, financial debt, financial intermediation. It provided deep and liquid bond markets that were open to the world. And all of these gave the Federal Reserve the leverage over global financial conditions. And it's a leverage that the Federal Reserve enjoys even today when we look at their monetary policy and how that's going to affect the entire budget. So all of these preconditions were met by the dollar by the time it became a fiat currency, not even backed by a metallic standard. So this shows you the currency composition of FX reserves from 1947 to 2013. And if you see that around late 1940s and early 1950s, the dollar had taken over the British pound, which never really recovered its international currency status anymore. And the dollar remained at the top of the pile from then on. And of course, in recent times, it has been declining a little bit in terms of FX reserve share. The euro has been picking up. But the story is established that the dollar became the dominating international reserve currency. Now moving on to the second part of the story, when we look at the market share of FX reserves, while in 1999, comparing 1999 to 2010, the share of dollar has come down as a share in countries' foreign exchange reserves. And other currencies such as the euro, even to some extent the pound, that have started replacing dollar in their FX reserves. So countries are essentially diversifying in terms of the currency share of FX reserves. Which essentially means that we are increasingly moving towards a multipolar world, but it's not just a single reserve currency that satisfies the demand for liquidity, but there is scope and there is momentum in the international monetary economy for multiple currencies to coexist. And that is very important and relevant to today's discussion. So in my own research, what we have found is, especially from the early 2000s, and this gives you a chart of local currency holdings by US investors, and these are local currencies of emerging markets. So since 2000, US investors' holding of local currency bonds have been going up, especially after the global financial crisis, and and these are bonds issued by East European emerging economies, Latin American countries, as well as Asian emerging economies. Right? So this is a trend that we would not have seen before 2000, because back in the 1990s, emerging countries suffered from what we call the original sin, where they were not able to issue bonds in their own currencies, they could only issue bonds in the dollar. But as the macro fundamentals of emerging countries started improving, today they've reached a stage where India or China can issue masala bond or dim sum bond respectively, and foreign investors are showing sufficient appetite for these bonds. Okay, so that's a phenomenal change that has happened from the 80s and 90s to the 2000s. Now, moving on of course to the second part. Now, while dollar and euro have been playing the role of the dominant international reserve currency, one contender that has been showing its head for the last 5-6 years, of course, is China. And especially since 2010, when traders in China were authorized to issue renminbi for invoicing trade settlements, since then China has taken a series of steps to internationalize the renminbi. In fact, very recently, the Bank of Japan signed an agreement to include renminbi in its foreign exchange reserves. So this is not an insignificant deal for an emerging market economy that was nowhere in the scenario as late as the 2000s. Now, when we look at the China and the internationalization of renminbi, going back to the essential attributes that I was referring to, in terms of scale, of course, as we all know, that China has achieved the scale. It is the world's largest trading nation today, a $10 trillion economy. And by 2030, it is supposed to account for 28% of global GDP, which is even higher than the US. So technically speaking, the renminbi can have an even larger platform for launching itself than the US economy. And that's a phenomenal development. However, what China doesn't have is, it's in size, it's significantly smaller in terms of international financial transactions compared to the US. So while in terms of absolute economy, nominal GDP size or trade, it has achieved scale, but in terms of financial transaction, it still has a long, long way to go. Moving over to stability, the second point, it has several aspects. It's financial, economic, and political. And because it's not a talk on China, I won't go too much into the details. Of course, financial and economic stability in China also has a long way to go. Its banking sector is still saddled with massive amounts of non-performing assets, very similar to India, and banking reforms are extremely urgently needed. But what is unique to China is all other international issuers of currency early in the 19th and 20th centuries were political democracies, where the elected systems and the contested elections imposed national checks and balances on the power of the executive. And that is something that China clearly lacks. And the lack of political democracy could very well be a potential challenge in fostering stability and confidence of the users in the value of the renminbi. The third point is liquidity, and there, like a lot of other Asian markets, the size of the local currency bond market is very small. And they have excessive amount of capital controls in place, not very different from India. And all of these act as a deterrent in improving liquidity in the financial market. So while they have been taking a lot of efforts, a lot of these efforts are targeted in the Hong Kong market, not really in mainland China, where there is still a lot of capital controls and a lot of regulations in the banking sector and the financial markets. And in that sense, we are closer to China than we are, in fact, by a long stretch, to US or the Eurozone. So now moving on to the last part, where we look at the macro preconditions for rupee internationalization. In terms of scale, where today we are the seventh largest economy, with a $2.3 trillion size, it is the fastest growing major economy, and we have surpassed China since 2014-04. And it is said that we do have the potential to become the world's third largest economy by the next decade, which is all very good. But in terms of scale, in terms of size, there's still a long way to go. And especially if you look at international financial transaction scale or share of trade in the global trade, we definitely have a long stretch to cross. As I said, India's trade in world trade is less than 3%. So that's significantly less than China as we stand today. In terms of stability, again, a very important factor. So oftentimes the literature says that, you know, scale is relatively easy to achieve because it's just one thing that you have to become big and you have to trade more. But stability is a lot harder. And one important factor in stability is inflation, because that can have a corrosive impact on investors holding nominally denominated instruments or even for doing international business in the currency. As far as India is concerned, well, of late inflation has been declining, partly because of global factors and because of a monetary tightening regime that we have been following. Policy credibility seems to have been established to some extent because fiscal deficit has been reduced and inflation targeting has been adopted, at least on paper. So we seem to be moving in that direction. And also one advantage that we have over China is, like other countries with international currencies, we are a political democracy. And that gives confidence to foreign investors that, that there is a stability factor associated with that political regime. However, when we talk of stability, of course, there are a lot of other issues in the banking sector. Again, NPA problem. Our financial markets are far from being deep and liquid, which is the next point. And that is where I think the primary challenges for rupee internationalization lie, which is that we don't have a deep and liquid bond market, which was one of the preconditions satisfied by the US dollar, for instance, way back in the early 1900s. We don't have hedging opportunities against all possible risks, and that is also a deterrent against having liquidity in the markets. There continues to exist a comprehensive set of capital controls, and the research shows that one thing that's going in favor of us in terms of liquidity is a positive function of a country size, of market size, and we are a growing economy, which is a good thing. But liquidity is also a problem if a country has a comprehensive and extensive set of capital controls, because a growing population of international investors is necessary if you want to give liquidity to the local currency bond market. And of course, there's a chicken and egg problem because you need liquidity to attract foreign investors and you need foreign investors to improve liquidity. And how do we solve that problem? So that's one thing. And again, we are in a managed floating exchange rate regime, and there, of course, there's this impossible trinity argument that once we have inflation targeting that we have adopted, and if you want to open up the capital account, we cannot possibly be intervening very actively in the foreign exchange market because they are going to be hitting the impossible trinity time. So that's a direct conflict right there. So, these are some of the challenges that I think in terms of macro preconditions the Indian economy has been facing, and I'll conclude my talk saying that, of course, steps must be taken, and this is not unknown to this audience, to facilitate financial development, to improve financial stability and liquidity before we can even think of internationalizing the rupee. And I think it's a long, long way to go, but we are taking steps in the right direction, and if we follow some of these measures, then maybe who knows, one day will come, then rupee can also be used for FX reserves, for dollar for denomination of bonds, and for trade invoices. Okay, so with that, I would like to give it over to that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rajeshwari, for setting the tone.